Okay, it's my pleasure to start our online international seminar. And our speaker today is Tomas Simtonen from University of Helsinki, Finland, and he will be speak. He's very good expert about this mostly of homogeneous type harmonic analysis, homogeneous type metric structure or something like this. And today, which is one side sparse dominations. And okay, please start.
Okay, thanks a lot for the introduction, and thanks for having me here. Quite a lot has happened since I accepted the invitation. This is my first wartime talk, something that I didn't want, of course. My full sympathy and admiration for the courage of the Ukrainian people. But now to the topic. So indeed, I'm from here. I'm also now part of the new Center of Excellence that we were just granted since the beginning of this year. I'm mentioning it here.
I also hope that Ukraine will be the what Finnish people have done 1939. Yes, I wish this story will be repeated again.
Thanks.
What is Finnish people have done now? Ukraine will be the same. And okay, let's wish success and peace. Okay, continue.
Okay, let's go to the mat. So here is I have a rough plan. It's not really a table of contents. Maybe a couple of questions that I try to at least touch. Okay, so what? First of all, I think I find it a good idea to try to explain the keywords in the title. So what is sparse domination? And okay, the singular integrals were not on the title, but they also appear. And what are one-sided singular integrals? Maybe how do these two topics connect to weighted norm inequalities? And finally, towards the end, I will have an application, which is, let's say, in the direction of boundary value problems. Maybe if this is your speciality, don't get too excited about it, because we don't really solve any significant new boundary value problem, but it's a kind of an application motivated by some function spaces arising from boundary value problems. Okay, but just to set the stage a little bit, something that I will be, so there is this keyword sparse that start from, in order to be able to talk about sparse domination, we need to have the notion of sparse families of cubes. In principle, the definition one could make it for any collection of sets, but usually the sets, in at least in these talks, will be cubes, and actually moreover dyadic cubes now living in RD. And we say that it's gamma sparse, so the sparseness comes with a parameter which I will usually not emphasize too much. But the point is that each of the sets, they will have pairwise, roughly speaking, they have pairwise disjoint major subsets EQ. And what does it mean? That being a major subset means that the EQ always takes a fixed, at least a fixed percentage of the original cube, and the disjoint just means what it usually means, that the intersection is empty of any two different ones of these subsets. So this is what we understand by sparse for collections of sets. And how these usually come up, it's maybe the no object has been around longer than the terminology, or it exists under different names. Quite often they arise in some kind of iterated stopping time constructions of the following type. So we have a process for a given cube, somehow to pick a family SQ of its subcubes, which satisfies the property that the total measure of these, okay, I didn't mention that, we think of them being pairwise disjoint subcubes. and their total measure adds up to some alpha, which is strictly less than one, at most a fixed fraction less than one of the whole original cube. And then we define, if we do it like this, then we can define EQ as the Q where we remove all these selected subcubes. And because the total measure of these is at most alpha times the measure of Q, so then this set has measure at least one minus alpha times the measure of Q. And okay, this is what we do for an individual cube. So then how we construct a sparse family, or we start from some disjoint collection of cubes, quite often just one cube, and then we, this is our zero generation, and then we form the, correct. So once we have the kth generation cubes chosen, we take all these selected subcubes of each of them, and the totality of all these collections will be our k plus one generation. And then the whole sparse collection is the, when we add up, take the union over all these sub collections. And then it's fairly easy to see that the EQ is defined like this. The EQ will always be disjoint from all the, not only, actually not only from the EQs, but from all the smaller cubes. And on the other hand, because the whole Q itself is disjoint from all the previous EQs. So this EQs will have the disjointness property, and this construction ensures that these form a major subset of the original ones. So this is kind of the abstract process that in concrete situation, it requires specifying this somehow. It depends on the context, how exactly we pick them. Okay, so now that we have this notion in place, we are in a position to define the sparse operators and what we mean by sparse domination. And this is, the averages play a big role here. I have some different competing notations for an average of a function over a cube Q. And then I also need this LS version of it, where it's kind of the average adapted to the LS norm. And I also, if I multiply a cube by a constant, by a number, I mean the concentric dilation, fairly standard notation. And then, okay, so now comes the, here is actually, I have two versions of the sparse operator, or actually I have a sparse operator and a sparse bisublinear form. I will actually mainly be interested about this version in this talk, but just to put it a little bit into perspective, I define these both versions here. So what do we do here? So if A is just a notation, let's say A for average, but we take a sum over all these cubes in our sparse collection. On each of the cubes, we place the value which is given by the average, or the LS average of F, possibly on a slightly expanded cube. If H is one, it's just on the same cube. If H is bigger than one, in a slightly expanded cube. And sometimes there is this kind of the bisublinear version, where, which is sort of how to understand this is that think of this this operator and multiply it by a function g and integrate. Then you basically arrive at this one with k equal to one and t equal to one. But sometimes you also need, it's also necessary to take a kind of a higher order average of the other function g. So then if t is bigger than one, then this does not directly arise from A, but it might arise from some other construction. But always we sum over, the point is that we sum over a sparse collection of cubes, then we have some kind of averages or LS, LT averages of the functions on these cubes. So these are relatively, I mean, not completely trivial operators, but relatively simple operators. In particular, these are operators where cancellation plays no role, because especially in this LS average, I have the absolute values inside, so it's just about the size of the functions. I okay, of course, this also depends. I have suppressed the h and k from this notation. Usually they take some fixed value throughout the entire consideration. And by now, there is quite a lot about this sparse domination in the literature. I will not give anything close to a complete review, but just mention some cases that appear, maybe the main cases. So it means that there exists some constants which only depend on the t, not on particular functions that appear in the subsequent formulae. But maybe the first, or the let's say the simplest version, is when we have a pointwise sparse domination for all functions f, at least in some class of test functions. There exists a sparse subcollection of dyadic cubes, which is gamma sparse with a fixed gamma, such that the operator t acting on f in absolute value is pointwise dominated by a fixed constant times this sparse operator acting on f. And maybe it's worth once mentioning that the order of the quantifiers, the existential quantifier comes after f, so the particular sparse collection is allowed to depend on the function f. So it's not that we dominate an operator, it's not by a fixed other operator here, the operator heavily depends, this is a very nonlinear dependence. What makes it useful is that all the quantitative details, all the actual constants that appear here are supposed to be uniform over the choice of f. And so when we want to prove some estimates for the operator, what we need is that we need estimates that are uniform for all sparse operators with fixed parameters, but independent of what particular sparse collection we are using. Okay, but this is the pointwise form. Then there is the bilinear form, which is that we can dominate not TF by itself. By the way, here it's kind of the bilinear version is clearly weaker than the pointwise. If we have the pointwise version, we just multiply by G, integrate, and then we end up with this one. But sometimes what makes it useful is that sometimes one can prove the bilinear domination even in the lack of a pointwise domination. And maybe the third version, which is actually the one that was the first one that appeared in the literature, is the norm domination, the bilinear and the norm are not strictly comparable to each other, but either one follows from the pointwise version here, or at least if X is some appropriate, let's say, Banach function space norm, that now the F, not necessarily pointwise, but in the norm of an appropriate space that we are interested in, is dominated by the corresponding norm of a sparse operator. So again, from this formula, it's clear if we can prove the boundedness of all sparse operators uniformly in this space X, then we get the boundedness of the operator T. And okay, a little technical detail. So usually, in order that any of these can be true in concrete cases, one usually needs at least one of the following. Either one needs to consider expanded dyadic cubes, for example, with the parameter h equal to 3 here, or if one insists in having h equal to 1, then it's usually necessary to not just take a fixed system of dyadic cubes, but sort of several slightly shifted, more or less to either using expanded cubes or shifted cubes, they play a more or less similar role in the end. Okay, it's still relatively abstract. Now let's try to connect it to some operators that are maybe more standard in harmonic analysis, the singular integrals. So now for the purposes of this talk, Calderon-Sigmund operator, for me, it is an operator that I initially assume it's bounded on L2. It's a different business to find conditions that guarantee this, but let me take this now as part of the definition for this talk. And then, okay, here maybe one should say that just for X outside the support of F and all the usual things. And for the sake of simplicity, so this is the maybe the usual, the so-called standard size condition. For the sake of simplicity, let me just write the smoothness in this form. Experts will know that one can, for many purposes, and also for the purposes of this talk, one could relax this to so some Herder of continuity with appropriate scaling, or some Dini continuity with an appropriate modulus of continuity. But let me not insist too much on this point. This is already sufficiently interesting to consider this condition here. Okay, so now with these definitions in place, one can give some concrete results here. So this is more or less where the sparse domination started from, the at least in the way that it's understood now, the recent line of or the last 10 years of activity from work of André Lerner, who proved that the all Caldron-Sigmund operators on any Banach function space X satisfy this kind of norm domination or sparse domination in the norm sense. And then it was sort of an open and problem for some years whether it could be possible to improve it to a pointwise domination. And it was done in actually several people more or less at the same time managed to establish this one. This is Fedya Nazarov, is the Nazarov here. And then another interesting development in roughly the last 5 years or 6 years came from a paper of Bernikot, Peter Michel and Frey, and now it has been followed also by many others. So of course, in the points one and two, Caldron-Sigmund operators, as many of you certainly know, even if we assume them to be just L2 bounded, they are bounded on LP for all P between one and infinity. But then there are other interesting operators which may be LP bounded only in some subrange of the exponents. And it's mainly for this type of operators that this bisublinear sparse domination comes up. So then, but still for many operators beyond the standard Caldron-Sigmund class, one can establish this kind of bisublinear sparse domination, usually with some exponents bigger than one. By now there are very, very many, but this Bernikot, Peter Michel, Frey was the first paper that opened this line of investigation. Okay, and still referring to the questions that or the kind of table of contents that I mentioned in the beginning, I also wanted to connect this a little bit to weighted norm inequalities. So a little review of this one. This side of the coin, given an operator T, we would, well, maybe two basic questions. One, what are the good weights W such that T is bounded with respect to the weighted LP norm? Here is the weighted LP norm, just for the sake of reference. And quite often for many operators, the answer is that the good weights, for example, for the Caldron-Sigmund operators, we know since the classical work of Mockenhaupt, Oviden, Koichman, Pfefferman, that the correct answer is the AP class defined by this product of average of the weight and the dual weight. Okay, but once we know what are the good weights, then we can ask the second question, how does the implied constant in this inequality depend on the AP constant of the weight? And let maybe for this one, let me give some answers. This question or study line was more or less opened by Buckley in 93, and he was able to answer the question precisely for the maximal, usual Hardy-Littlewood maximal operator, that the answer is that it grows with this power rate, or let's say it's dominated by this power rate growth, and this is optimal in general. In some cases, it really actually grows at this rate. And then for the sparse operators, this is a very selective history. I'm dropping very many results in the course of the development, just some selection. But kind of connecting to this sparse topic, Cruz, Uribe, Martel, and Perez in 2010 proved that these satisfy, and this is actually not only they proved this, but they found a very simple and elegant proof of this one, that for the sparse operators, it's very easy to prove this kind of a dependence, which is slightly bigger than what is the, or let's say for some p, it's the same as the, for maximal operator, but when p grows to infinity, we have this one instead of a decaying exponent. And then a couple of years later, or this is the publication year, I managed to prove, and again, of course, I said I'm skipping a lot of history. So for several special cases of Caldron Sigmund operators, this was known earlier, for example, by Stefani Petermihl. But the kind of the full case, I completed it. This was called the A2 conjecture, or now the A2 theorem, that this is also the correct bound for Caldron Sigmund operators. At this point, the two results were sort of not yet only connected in spirit, but not really directly. But then a simplified proof of this bound was found by André Lerner by showing that it can actually be reduced to the Cruz Uribe Martel Perez result. That one can dominate a general Caldron Sigmund operator by the sparse operator, and therefore one has the same bound. So the original proof of this bound for Caldron Sigmund operators was a little bit different. It did not use the sparse domination, but now the sparse domination is the simplest way of getting to this bound. And yeah, now there are for many other operators, there are related results, and the sparse domination is kind of the standard approach to get this kind of sharp quantitative estimates. Quantifying getting a good dependence on the weight constant. That's usually the most efficient way is typically via the sparse domination estimates. Okay, several slides before I got to that. So there is the other keyword from my title that I finally want to get into. So one-sided, or as you will see, one could also call it causal, as you will shortly see operators. So, okay, this is just recalling the previous definition, Caldron Sigmund operator. And now let's be, instead of generalizing, I'm actually restricting. So I'm want to consider a more specific class. I add another assumption. Suppose in addition that if the y1 variable, the first coordinate of y is bigger than the first coordinate of x, then actually the kernel is zero. So in other words, we can write the integral in this form, in the y1 variable, so after x1, it becomes zero, so we only need to integrate up to x1. And yeah, so if now the first coordinate represents time, then what this says is that tf only depends on the past values of f. And actually, to make it even a little bit more concrete, let's now mainly concentrate. One can say things in higher dimensions, but let me mainly concentrate now in dimension one, where somehow the other integral goes away. We just have that the tf at x should be the integral from minus infinity to x of the kernel times f. So this is the one-sided because we just have the one side of the kernel, or causal, for the obvious reason. The current value of the transform only depends on the past values of the function, not about the future. Okay, now a fair question is, one can of course make this definition, are there any reasonable examples? Because what one could make one doubt about the existence of examples is the fact that maybe the singular integrals that most immediately come to mind have essential cancellation between y bigger than x and y smaller than x, for example, via the antisymmetry of the kernel. So now if a kernel is both antisymmetric and causal, then it's identically zero kernel, so not much to say about this one. So for example, there maybe the most prominent example, the Hilbert transform, is exactly like this. It is antisymmetric, it's living on both sides of when y is bigger than x and y is smaller than x, and it is quite essential because there is the boundedness of the Hilbert transform comes from the cancellation between these values. If we try to, of course, we could just truncate this kernel x bigger than y, then instead of a sign-changing kernel, we create a positive kernel, but that also is the kernel of an unbounded operator. So that's not no longer a, if we kill the singularity or the sign change of the Hilbert transform in this way, then we no longer have a bounded operator on L2. So this is something that one could reasonably make one doubt whether there is any point in studying one-sided operators. But, okay, there is a, let me first, so but nevertheless, I mean, and I will actually mention more about this paper, but this there is a paper by Aymar Forzani, Martin Reyes from 97, and they have an example. Actually, what I say show is not exactly their example, but it's almost the same as their example. Still has, let's take almost the same form as trying to truncate the Hilbert transform. We take a convolution kernel, but just on a, for x bigger than y. So now we need to specify what is k for positive values. And let's just take this one. 1 over t times the sine of the logarithm of t. Okay, the sine is at most 1, so clearly this satisfies the Calderon-Zygmund size condition. It's at most 1 over t, which is 1 over t to the power d, because t is equal to 1. And if we differentiate, we find that, again, this is something at most 1, or let's say at most 2, and this is 1 over t squared. So it has the correct derivative condition as well. And okay, now how to check the L2 boundedness? I will resort to a classical condition from the theory of convolution type Calderon-Zygmund kernels. So if we integrate this kernel from any A to B, well, now one, this is kind of a high school calculus essentially. We recognize that the 1 over t is the derivative of the inner functions, and the sine is the derivative of minus cosine, so we get some cosines, and this is again, it's uniformly bounded for all a and b, no matter how far they are apart. So this is kind of a cancellation here that gives the L2 boundedness. So it's kind of like a one-sided Hilbert kernel with slow modulation. And yeah, the kernel bounds this one plus the cancellation here, they give the boundedness on L2 by classical theory. So there are examples, or there is at least one example. And actually one can put this same example in a more general context, and then there are other, maybe another interesting instance worth pointing out, but let me first give the general context. So now let's consider a phi z, a function which is bounded and holomorphic, not just on the positive line, but in a little sector around it. Well, if that's the case, then we can write the derivatives, the nth derivative at a positive t. We make a little circle around the point t, and of course we can, well, in this sector we can make the circle bigger and bigger the further t is on the towards the infinity, and with that making some simple estimates, one checks that then the derivatives of the function must decay like 1 over tn, or decay at infinity and blow up at zero at most at the rate 1 over tn. So now let's define again a truncated convolution type kernel where our kt is the derivative of such a function. The first derivative, so it has the correct size bound, and then the first derivative of k is the second derivative of phi, which has the correct derivative bound. And on the other hand, because k is a derivative of a bounded function, so then it also has this, when we integrate from any a to b, we have just two values of phi, and so it is bounded. So the previous example can be actually seen as an instance of this. We take the, as phi is the minus cosine of logarithm of z, one can check that this is bounded by the hyperbolic cosine of alpha in the sector where the argument is smaller than alpha, and then the, by differentiating this, we get the exactly the previous example. But why I wanted to give this context is that another interesting class of examples comes if we allow for operator valued kernels. Then if A is possibly unbounded, typically unbounded operator on a Banach space X, which generates a bounded holomorphic semigroup. So exactly in this kind of a sector, then it satisfies exactly the same assumptions, only its operator value. And okay, so then we are led into considering this kind of an operator. Now the k, this function here, is a times the semigroup, and if we are restricted to functions just supported on the positive line, this is just integral from 0 to x. This might be a formula looking familiar, or goes with the name variation of constants formula, or also known as the maximal regularity operator. This has been studied quite a lot, and in particular, I mean, there are many papers I could mention, but maybe I mention in particular, there is a relatively recent paper by Ralph Chill and Sebastian Kroll, where they kind of systematically exploit the theory of one-sided singular integrals to gain some insight into this maximal regularity operator. So I'm not dealing with a theory without examples. Okay, so now that this is settled, let me maybe go to some questions that one can ask, and at least part of them to answer about the one-sided Hadron-Sigmund operators. But okay, maybe also some remarks. So one kind of an obvious thing, but worth emphasizing. One-sided Hadron-Sigmund operators are Hadron-Sigmund operators. So everything that we know about Hadron-Sigmund operators is valid in particular for the one-sided versions. So really everything that I want to address here is we are dealing with the operators with an additional property. How can we exploit this property? What more can we say about the one-sided operators? This is the whole point. So for example, what are the largest classes of admissible weights to make them bounded? And once we know the classes of weights, what are the optimal weighted inequalities? And is there a related sparse domination principle? Because now, again, so here I recall this simplest form of the pointwise sparse domination, which is valid for any Hadron-Sigmund operator, so in particular for one-sided Hadron-Sigmund operators. It is valid, no question about this. The problem is that it loses information about the causality of T, because the right-hand side here, let's say we take, okay, let's think of one dimensional. Let's think that X is so the cubes are intervals. Let's take X, for example, the middle point of the interval Q. And then here we have the average of F on the whole cube. So it's also looking both to the past, but also to the future from the middle point. It's not, this can never be causal except in the trivial case where it's zero. So we would ideally, since the left-hand side is causal, we would like to have a domination by something which is causal on the, also on the right hand side. Okay, but now let me again jump back a little bit to the history. Already quite some time ago, there is the notion of the one-sided maximal operator came up. And now here is the subscript W. So this is the weighted version. Just to save space, I immediately gave the weighted version. But the point is really that if you forget the weight for the while, it's just that you integrate at the point X, you consider. So this is the weighted measure of this interval, but just in there. So it's just dividing by H if the weight is absent. So we consider averages of F, but averages that on intervals not centered at X, but that end at the point X, that extend to the past from the point X, in contrast to the usual, for example, centered maximal operator. An interesting historical curiosity is the fact that this actually was the way that Hardy and Littlewood originally defined the maximal operator. Their original version was actually the one-sided. That's how they defined it back in 1930. But now some result, because now I'm concerned with the weights. So the Mockenhaupt, this is the classical Mockenhaupt result. So the maximal operator, so now just the usual no weight here, but unweighted maximal operator is bounded on the weighted LP space if and only if we have the AP, Mockenhaupt AP condition. But now, then Eric Sawyer in the 80s studied this one-sided maximal operator. And now, and he observed that indeed it admits a rather bigger class of weights. So now on the next slide, I comment on the fact that it is really genuinely bigger. So we take the supremum over all intervals, but now instead of having the average of W and the dual weight on the same interval, I take the average of W on the right half of the interval and the average of the dual weight on the left half. So I'm comparing the weight and the dual weight not on the same interval, but on two adjacent intervals of equal length, and in such a way that they are always in the same order. The dual weight is always on the left of the actual way. Okay, here I didn't have enough space here, so here is the definition of the dual weight, just to recall. And now here is also what I had before. So for the quantitative bound, the optimal dependence by Buckley for the usual maximal operator and in the usual AP class is like this. Again, this is still for the usual maximal operator. A new proof of Buckley's result, the simplest proof known by now, I think, is by Andre Lerner again, was found via the fact that the unweighted maximal operator can be dominated by, there is the AP constant, and it's a composition of two weighted maximal operators. It's a relatively, actually, one sort of, once you know what to prove, it's kind of a relatively straightforward algebraic manipulation. You just divide and multiply by the appropriate quantities, and at some point you extract this AP constant more or less by definition. And now I should mention there is the more fairly recent, kind of reproving Sawyer's theorem, but at the same time obtaining the sharp quantitative bound matching with Buckley's theorem by Martin Reyes and De La Torre from 2015. So this is the exact analog of Buckley, just replacing M by the one-sided M and the AP by the one-sided AP. And the proof, basically via Lerner's, a natural analog of Lerner's formula, just again replacing M minus by or here is M minus, here is actually M sigma in both. And really the key in both Lerner's proof and this one is the fact that the weighted, so weighted maximal operator on the weighted LP space, so both for the usual, for the centered one and the one-sided one, these satisfy, such bounds are independent of the, they are, do not require the AP condition or anything. For any weight W, this only, the estimate only depends on B. This depends basically on the fact that the covering properties of intervals in the on the real line. So once you have the domination by these weighted maximal operators, these do not introduce any dependence on the weight. The whole dependence on the weight is already in this formula. So you can see here is the weight constant and the correct power is already in this pointwise bound. Okay, and now I mentioned this, that the one-sided weights is genuinely a bigger class. So here just to recall about definitions, now I'm afraid that here I probably put these ones in the, because at some point, yeah, it should be I plus with the W and I minus with sigma. Unfortunately, they are in the wrong order in my, this would be the definition of the so-called AP plus. But for this particular proof, it does not, yeah, so the plus and minus are in the wrong order in this, on this slide. Sorry for that. Yeah, but in any case, the proof is the same, that the average on half of the interval, it is at most twice the average on the full interval. So one easily derives this bound. But then to the other direction, one can check that actually any decreasing weight is in this class. And this is actually, maybe I guess I'm using a bit more time than I wanted at this point. So maybe I skipped it. It's a relatively, I don't go this through in detail. It's quite a straightforward from the definition to go through this argument. But this, for example, gives, for example, something like an exponential weight e to the power minus x, is one quickly checks that it's not in the usual AP class, but obviously it's decreasing, so it will be in AP minus. So there are really quite many examples of such. Okay, but now let's go back to the one-sided singular integrals and the weights. Again, also a little bit of comparison with the usual singular integrals. This is the classical result that I mentioned. Usual Caudron-Sigmund operators are bounded in LP, all of them if and only if we are dealing with an AP weight. And then in 97, Aymar Forsani and Martin Reyes showed that for causal, so this is a smaller class, there are more admissible weights. The one-sided weights are enough for the one-sided Caudron-Sigmund operators. It's kind of elegant. And essentially the proof is a causal adaptation of the classical argument using the good lambda method and reducing it then to the boundedness of the one-sided maximal operator. And to actually prove this good lambda inequality, it's also, this is where the causal adaptation comes, for one considers the maximal subintervals of the set. So this is, by the way, actually that T star is the maximal truncation of the operator T, maximal subintervals of this open set. And then one does a one-sided Whitney decomposition. So intervals which kind of accumulate using intervals whose distance from one endpoint is proportional to the length of the interval, but then at the other end they are just we allow big intervals coming there, but this is just the key elements of the proof. Okay, now this is again I'm repeating the result that I mentioned there. For usual Caudron-Sigmund operators, the sharp weighted inequality is this, Now, I think it's a reasonable conjecture that for one sided here, I just put this minus to emphasize that I'm talking about the one sided or causal operators, that they, by the result of Aymar and co-authors, we know that they will be bounded provided that W is in this class. But what is the optimal dependence? One would expect that maybe the same as for the usual one, but this is not known. The best result in this direction that I'm aware of is relatively recent by Michael Lacey and two co-authors, Chen and Han, that the, okay, so here is the case P equal to 2 and not the Calderon-Sigmund operators, but certain simplified discrete analogs, so-called Martingale transforms, they do satisfy this inequality. And okay, how one could expect to prove this if one, okay, now the kind of the most efficient proof of the first bound is via sparse domination. If one had an appropriate, one would expect that a reasonable approach would be via some kind of a one-sided version of sparse domination, but we are not so far aware of such a result or a version of such a result that would be powerful enough to get this. Okay, but I didn't want to only mention the open problem, so I wanted to say something about what we can do. Maybe I call it semi-causal sparse domination by myself and Andreas Rosén. So now T is a causal Calderon-Sigmund operator. Then what we can prove is that there exists, for every function, there exists a sparse collection, subcollection of a fixed dyadic system such that, okay, so now I explicitly wrote the intervals in this form A up to A plus T. We have the indicator of the interval as before. And now we have kind of a hybrid of a shifted and expanded interval. So it expands to the left of the original one. This is nice because that's kind of in line with causality. And it does not quite reach up to the right endpoint. We leave a good gap. It goes halfway through the, maybe the half is not really critical here, but this is just the point is that it extends some way through the interval, but not to the, but with a clear, with a quantitative gap from the right endpoint. This is what we can prove. Okay, but now let's start with bad news about this bound. So here, of course, this one, in part, there is A up to A plus T, so it's bigger than A up to half T, and this average is bigger or up to a constant bigger than the average over this one. So on the right, we do have indicators and averages on the same equal interval. And basically, this kind of, whenever we have something like this, even just one term, but uniformly, it's the only way that this kind of averaging operators are bounded on LPW is that we need to have an AP weight. So we didn't, by having this kind of a sparse domination, this semi-causal sparse domination is not enough to get anything beyond there. We already know that they are bounded in AP for Mackenhaus weight. We know actually that they are bounded for more general weights, but we cannot recover this result from this domination. So now it's a fair question, did we gain anything at all? And well, okay, maybe I first explain. So especially we have an application, which is basically, if we deal with in the singular integrals on a half line and then the dyadic intervals on the half line. Now, whenever we have a dyadic interval of this type, so this one is entirely on the negative half line. And then if we look at any of these intervals, we see that because A plus T is still negative, so A plus half T is at least the distance half T away from zero. So anything that appears here is sort of a Whitney type interval. And that's something that one can use, not for the weighted bounds, but for something else. I think I will, if there is time in the end, maybe I come back to the proof. Let me now show what is it is useful for. So what, there is a function space arising from boundary value problems. My co-author Andreas is a much better expert than me on this topic, but I think I'm able to give the definitions. So maybe a little bit strange function space to on a first look. So we have for a functions on the upper half space, we consider a norm which is formed of several elements. So the W stands for a Whitney average, C for a Carlesson functional. And now for the sake of simplicity, I'm giving the dyadic versions of these ones related to dyadic cubes. Actually, one also needs to consider a certain continuous version, but it's in spirit the same. So the Whitney averaging is just that the, okay, this kind of the Whitney cubes where we have a dyadic cube on the, on RD, and then this is a, well, it's actually not really a cube, it's a rectangle, but this is the, so this, the length is LQ in all other directions and half LQ in the transversal direction, and the distance from the boundary is also half LQ. So on each of these cubes, we replace the function by its LQ average. That's the first thing that we do. And the second thing is the C, the Carlesson functional. And now we sort of project from D plus one dimensions to D in a way that at any point X on RD, we look at the dyadic cubes that contain this point, and then we take an average of G, but I cheated a little bit. It should actually not be an average. We should divide just by the measure of R, not by R hat. I oversimplified the notation a little bit. But the point is in any case that we integrate over this R hat, which is the interval R, and then we take a box around it, or a box, we extend it to a cube in one higher dimension. Notice, by the way, that this WQ is the upper half of Q hat. So these are the two elements. And then finally, we are down to a function of D variables, we take the LP norm. So this is something that it sort of encodes of the function F, some kind of local interior LQ regularity, transversal, so in the upward pointing direction, L1 regularity in terms of this Carlesson functional, and then LP regularity along the boundary. This is a space that has been used for as a solution space for some boundary value problems by Koenig and Pfeiffer, and then by Osser and Axelsson. Axelsson is actually the same person as my co-author Rosén. He just changed his surname at some point. Yeah, so this is the function space. And now some things that it's worth knowing about this function space is that general Caudron-Sigmund operators, even quite, one doesn't need to cook up some strange examples, but even quite natural examples need not be bounded on this function space. Basically, the reason is that, I mean, the LQ component and the LP, when P and Q are strictly between one and infinity, are sort of okay, but then this Carlesson functional is sort of an L1 kind of object, and L1 is usually not good for singular integrals. To actually check this in detail, we don't have a particularly simple way to see, but in any case, it's doable. But morally, it comes from the fact that there is an L1 component and singular integrals are not nice on L1. But the new result that we can prove with the help of the sparse domination result that I just mentioned, or the kind of the higher dimensional analog of that, is that if we have a downwards mapping, so now a causal operator in higher dimensions, but causal in the sense that whatever the value of the transform at any level only depends on the values of the function above this level. And this depends on how we prove it, is that we prove that this kind of downwards mapping causal singular integrals, they are dominated by downwards semi-causal sparse operators, and these sparse operators in turn are bounded on the space X that we are interested in. And the Whitney properties that I mentioned is the key here. As I warned you right in the beginning, we don't have a real killer application to boundary value problems yet. So this was, at this point, it's just that we can prove something for function spaces that arise in boundary value problems, not really about something concrete or not something that would actually solve a boundary value problem in a new way or more on this. Maybe to conclude, I still come to, now I mentioned the open questions that I already hinted at. So what should we actually expect about this one-sided sparse domination? Maybe the dream theorem would be that we would have a sum over a sparse collection, and then on the right-hand side of the interval, we would put the average of F on the left-hand side of the interval. This would clearly very strongly reflect the causal structure. Probably it would be, if this is not true, it could still be, there is kind of a weaker form which would still have the causality. Now maybe the dyadic structure is not as clean because now the indicator, here the indicator and the average are sort of completely decoupled. Here I have the indicator of the interval and the average on the same interval, but an indicator inside there. But this would still, even this one, it's a weaker result than this, but it would still be, also this one we don't know, and it would be quite interesting to know. Or maybe something else, but in any case, what we would like to use it for, well, okay, actually, one thing I could have mentioned as an intermediate, we would at the minimum, it should be something that recovers the result of Aymar Forsani and Martin Reyes. That's just to know that we know that the operators are bounded on the AP minus weighted spaces, but how to recover it from this sparse domination. But then the new weighted estimate, we would like to know the analog of this quantitative bound. Or maybe there is no one-sided sparse domination and one just needs a different proof for this one. Or maybe it's simply false, why not? But also this would be very interesting because to see that but I don't know, I mean the analogy of the one-sided weighted theory seems to extend with the classical weighted theories would seem to extend quite far. So it would be interesting to, if it turns out that it does not extend up to the sub-weighted inequality, either a positive or a negative statement, I think it would be quite interesting. But yeah, I guess I used the 1 hour, so thanks.
Okay. Thank you for nice, interesting talk. Oh, maybe we can unmute. You can, everybody can unmute yourself, and if somebody has questions. Hello, who?
There is something in the chat. No,
there is no questions in the chat.
Thank you.
Okay, if somebody wanted some questions or comments, please unmute yourself and ask. You can.
So this is Nagis.
Okay, please.
I think Caffarelli and Silvestre studied these non-local energies on Rn by considering harmonic extension to Rn cross 0 to infinity, the upper half space, but they are looking at the upper half space as a weighted upper half space where the weight is, you know, a power of the distance to the boundary. If you look at all of these harmonic extensions, there's a subclass of functions on the boundary, which is Rn, which are in the domain of this non-local fractional Laplacian. And I wonder whether somehow your technology can be adapted to identifying amongst all the harmonic functions in the upper half space, those whose trace happen to be in the domain of the fractional Laplacian. Is that possible?
Okay, that's an interesting question. I cannot say anything concrete for, it might be something to look at. It seems sort of within the limits of something that could be, but we certainly didn't look into this.
Thank you. Can I ask questions? Thomas, thank you for nice talk. And I have a question. What about one side potential, like Riemann or Weyl fractional integrals?
Okay. Yeah, that's actually another good.
Because this is originally by Sawyer by complex interpolation, and after this by also Martirians and some co-authors also studying this problem, and also houses. Maybe it's also could be.
Yeah. That could actually. I don't have something to. Could be another interesting.
Okay, you are not.
I'm not
in touch with this problem.
Next
talks. Okay, from my side, please, another question, comments from another.
Okay, I stop share so I can see you. But if someone has something to ask about the slides, I can put them back.
There is no more questions? Okay, please, yeah.
I have one question, but it's not related to this Thomas result. Perhaps after we will stop recording, I will ask a question about some of his other results.
Right, I'm fine with that, but
perhaps I do have a question. Maybe probably naive, but you talked about one-dimensional causal Sigmund operators. If you had this causal condition on other dimension, I mean higher dimension, would it be just composition of one dimensional, or it's different?
What I call the semi-causal sparse domination, we have a version of this in higher dimensions, and it's actually not. One needs kind of a little extra term that was not that was absent in the one dimensional case, but this extra term. It's still okay for there, because actually in this application to this Koenig Pfeiffer solution spaces, we use indeed the higher dimensional, but it's not. I would say, or at least the way we know it now, it's kind of using the same kind of ideas, but we don't really get it immediately from the one dimensional. Yeah, one needs a little extra work to get the higher dimensional, but it's not substantially different, but it still needs an slight extra argument, at least at our current understanding. I don't know really. Of course, it's not out of question that one might come up with a simple trick to reduce everything to one dimension, but at least so far I'm not aware of it.
Thanks.
Once I make another questions. About, you know, there is such problems about boundaries of singular integral, but restricted on the even or odd functions. There is such Adam's study, I think Lubosch also, and we are studying also. And how this will be, because I have not seen this research about by this best constant of, because if you make changes of variables, this problem is reducing some one positive line singular integral, but not real Calderon-Zygmund, but somehow I managed that some metrics still will be homogeneous type spaces in a positive line you can define that still can you get some result, but as you consider in the lines, you only consider Lebesgue distance, yes?
Sorry, Amiran, it wasn't Adams, it was Ken Andersen.
Andersen.
Technical remark.
Andersen. But Adams also studied more derivatives is zero, yes?
Possibly.
Yes, okay.
On the one side, it's that thing that you mentioned was...
It's not really one side, because sometimes it's not precisely Calderon-Zygmund of data, but after this, I find some metrics. If you define, it will be Calderon, but as usually, one-dimensional Calderon operator with another metrics is not so considered, because you have no sparse sequences or operators for one dimensional case with another matrix, yes? Only there is.
There are some results. I mean, actually, one can make sense of some of the sparse technology even in the, let's say, the homogeneous space of homogeneous type kind of generality. So, in principle, the half line as such is not a problem. But
you need to use not this distance, the classical matrix, I think.
Yeah, but even this a priori, the fact that it's not a classical, because in principle the technology, or at least some part of the results are quite fine in a space of homogeneous type. But other than but I don't have anything. I did not. I mean, I'm sort of.
I think
aware, I'm aware of some of the results of this even or functions.
Somehow adapt these general definitions and these techniques. I think it will be no problem. Just only not consider for young students will be interesting problem. But okay, thank you. More questions? More comments? If not, we can thank speakers again. And